Hands here. Good morning, everyone. I feel really at home, even though I've been moving around a bit. It's so lovely to be here this morning, and there's an open atmosphere here. There's a freedom here that I've experienced every time that I've been here. It's not just a building; it's a family. There's really something of an ease when you walk in here, and I just want to commend you on that. And say that it's super exciting for me to be here and to share a word this morning. And thank you for having me. It's a big privilege. I tell this story quite a lot, but when I was a little child, probably about 3 or 4, I used to play in the school ground here. And this is now 30 years later, and God is faithful, you know, and I believe the seeds that Pastor Falk and the team have sown at that time already. You know, when you're a child, you already receive things from the Lord. And I believe those seeds have grown, and it's a privilege to be here this morning and just to share the word. I always say that, you know, how do you recognize that Pastor Volker has the Spirit of God? You know, because a German speaks in one tone until the Holy Spirit comes and, you know, just gives you that passion and that desire. It's difficult for us to speak in a very lively manner, you know. So I'll do my best this morning. I'm still learning, and I'm inspired, you know, over the years. And yeah, it's such a privilege. I'll do my best. Do not fall asleep. Keep attentive. I believe the Lord has a word this morning for us. I'm going to be speaking about the beginning of wisdom. Okay, so it's going to go quite deep. Don't lose me. Don't lose the message. Okay, stick to it and listen carefully. Okay, so I'm going to go with the slides because that's going to help me as well. So the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom is something that we generally, humans, if you're a believer or not, wisdom is something that people seem to be looking for. It's something almost global. You know, you will find anyone in the world say, that was quite a wise thing that you did there, or I need some wisdom for this opportunity. And the word gets used quite a lot, and we seldom really get to the bottom of how do we ever get to wisdom? What is the source of wisdom? And I believe a lot of you already know where I'm going with this, but I want to go very deep this morning with it. Before I do that, however, I just want to pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you for this morning. I thank you for the privilege of sharing a word. I pray that the words that I'll share this morning will not come from my own strength or my own wisdom, Father, but from your Spirit. Not by might nor by power, but by your Spirit alone, Father. I pray that this word will find fertile soil and that you will speak, Father, in spite of me and because of me and through the mic and without the mic, Lord, through your Spirit, may you move this morning. It's all about you, Father. We give you the glory. And Father, you are the one who carries your word to people's hearts and to the nations. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So you've heard it said, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So I'm going to ask you guys at the back just to flip over as I speak. Deuteronomy 10 verse, okay, I'm going to read here from the slides. Deuteronomy 10 verse 12 to 14. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? But to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways and to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command you today for your good. Indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord your God, also the earth with all that is in it. You can go to the next one. Psalms says, praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation, like we've been doing. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. He has given food to those who fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. He has declared to his people the power of his works and giving to them the heritage of the nations. Next slide. The works of his hands are verity and justice. One back. All his precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever. Amen. Okay, so we see this topic of the fear of the Lord is being discussed quite often in the Bible. Throughout the Bible, it comes up, and the Bible says the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. But I think it can be quite problematic when we... can you go to the next slide? So, next one. All right, so Solomon asked for... what did he ask for when the Lord said, give me anything? Wisdom, right? I wonder sometimes when the Lord... if the Lord would come to me and say, ask me anything. If the Lord would come to you and say, ask me anything right now. If you truly would answer, you know, out of your heart, what will you say? I sometimes doubt. I will say, Lord, give me wisdom for leading your people. Now I can say it because I've studied his word, but in general, we want to ask the Lord many things. Solomon said, Lord, I need wisdom. I'm a young person. I need to lead your people. And the Lord gave him much more than that. So we see that wisdom is very important to the Lord. But when we speak of the fear of the Lord, I think it can be a bit of an issue sometimes in our culture, because fear has a bad connotation, right? When we speak of fear, if you look at my next slide, next one, go on. The beginning of wisdom, yes. Fear. Okay, so that's kind of the picture I get when I think of fear. In our culture, we have one way of thinking of it, and that is you are afraid of pain. You are afraid of something happening that's going to cause you to have to go through pain. Or there's also a picture I get of, you know, a master over his slave. That kind of pain that the slave, or that fear that the slave has for a master. And I think that's the picture we get. Go on. So, an unpleasant emotion caused by the threat of danger, pain, or harm. So, examples are fear of punishment, fear of pain or something unpleasant, and fear of missing out. Have you heard the acronym FOMO? So there's lots of fear going around in this day and age as well, you know, not just fear of a master or, you know, fear of something unpleasant happening, but also fear, like you at home on a Friday night, you make your rooibos tea and you sit in front of the TV maybe, and you get, all of a sudden you get a message and it says, oh, you should have been here. It's such a nice braai. And all of a sudden your peace leaves you and you're like, I should have been at that braai. Because of fear of missing out. You know, we with our cell phones especially, and with social media, we look at other people's events and things and we think, wow, I just need to be there or there. And we're never quite comfortable because there's this fear. So I just wanted to add that to this kind of fear that we think about often. But there are different types of fear that we see in the Bible. The next slide. So, the fear of the Lord. So, there are ways to explain it in different contexts. And that's why I say, please stick with me, because it can really change the way that you see the Lord. The fear of the Lord. So, there are different types of fear of the Lord as well. There is definitely the fear of an unpleasant consequence. There's the anxiety over breaking God's law. And there's also a healthy kind of fear that we see in the Bible, a profound reverence for life that comes from rightly seeing. Rightly seeing. And I want to add to that, rightly seeing God. So examples that I want to give of that is, you know, if you have moral respect for someone, moral reverence, it's a big word, reverence. But these kind of fear is what the Bible speaks about when it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So it's very, very important, because don't we want to be wise? Do you want to be wise? Fear the Lord. Martin Luther also struggled with this idea. So he came up with two explanations. He said, the one fear is servile fear, so this kind of fear of punishment. But the fear that we're going to talk about this morning mostly is the awe, the amazement, when you are full of this, you're staring at something of majesty. That's the kind of the fear of the Lord. He's so great, so wonderful, powerful. You're overcome by him because you see him for who he is. It's not the kind of fear that runs away. It's the kind of healthy amazement for the Lord. So if you go to the next slides, healthy fear. A profound reverence for life that comes from rightly seeing. The awe of the exalted, beholding God's glory and majesty, seeing God for who he is, moral reverence and a submissive attitude of respect. Moral reverence. So the way that I see this often is I'm reminded of when we were in high school, and you know, you go about your day, you go to class, you have the time in the world to do whatever you want, you chat to friends, you doodle in your book to pass the time of the subjects, and then the teacher announces exams. Tomorrow we will have a test. And it's as if magic happens. And I don't know if it was like that with you, but all of a sudden break time is being used for homework. You call up a friend to say, hey, I heard you understand the subject, can I quickly come by, can you explain the subject to me? And it's almost this kind of fear of, what will my parents say if I fail? Or what will the teachers say? Or, you know, I need to pass. And all of a sudden this fear comes on you, but it drives you forward. It makes you do things that normally, you know, time is just there and you've got all the time in the world. But then the teacher says, exams. Hey, for those of you who are in school, it's like that, eh? You, all of a sudden you get this energy and you're like, I need to pass. Hopefully. There's also healthy fear at your workplace, hopefully. If you work for someone, or at least I work for someone, and I'm so thankful to the Lord for my boss. He is a man that he doesn't tell you that you're going the wrong way. He just works twice as hard as you do. And you just feel, I need to do a bit more. I don't fear my boss, but he works so hard, and I see his example of what he does, and maybe he will hear this message even. But it's true. He's a wonderful guy. He walks with the Lord, you know, and he's got this attitude of just, he works quite hard, and you feel, I can do extra. Not because you want to, you know, suck up to him or, you know, but you want to also be as productive as he is and get things done. So he inspires you. That's a healthy kind of fear. A kid crossing the road. So parents, you know, those of you who have kids, if you see your kid running across the road, what will you do? You'll say, stop! And there's this healthy fear in the kid. The kid will feel a bit of a jolt, probably, hopefully. You grab the kid by the arm and say, don't cross the road like that. Don't run across the road. And that is a healthy fear for children to have when their parents stop, you know, and say, Johannes Jacobus van der Merwe. And you're like, okay, that's this kind of fear bubbles up inside of you because you know something is going to happen. But it is, we know as time passes that it's a healthy kind of fear, because you want to hopefully as a parent teach the child what to do and what not to do. As we go on, we look at the life of David. So we looked at Psalms 111. And you can skip this one. Okay, so what the Bible teaches. David said, the fear of the Lord is wisdom. And so did Job. If you read Job, the same phrase comes up. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. Or the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. We see it in Deuteronomy, which is quite early in the Bible. We already see that the Lord says, fear the Lord your God. Fear the Lord your God to walk in all his ways and to love him, to serve the Lord your God. So there's this definite emphasis on it. And David was a good example of that, you know. There was a time when they had to set up a camp or something at someone's grounds, and the person said, you are David, the king. You can have my grounds. And he said, no, I will honor the Lord and I will buy it from you. He had this certain thing of, yes, men have their things, but I will honor the Lord first. I will honor the Lord first. He had his problems as well. But he definitely was a good example. If you read through the Psalms, and his son Solomon as well, you know, seeking that wisdom of the Lord at the beginning of his life. It's definitely a good example in the Old Testament of the fear of the Lord. You know, first the Lord. Seek first the Lord and his kingdom. Amen. But there's one that definitely is a better example than the rest. There was one who, after David came, and he showed us the good example of the fear of the Lord. Let's look at Jesus. So, yes, fear can be an indicator of our desires, and what we desire can be an indicator of what we worship. Before I go to Jesus, I was praying about this morning, and I was praying about what should I say, and I really felt this thing of, what do I fear? If you think of your own life, some of us might have struggles with that, and we'll pray for you. But there are things that we fear, and if you go deep into that root in your mind of the fear, it usually has a different root to what you think. Say you are fearful that you're going to lose your job, just for an example. The root of that is that you are fearful that you won't have enough money, or that you can't provide for your family. And that fear is rooted probably in that you are worried that God won't provide for you, or life won't provide for you. And the deeper you go, you see, but wait a minute, this reveals a part of my heart. Something is revealed in my heart when I think of my fears. Sometimes it's shallow things, sometimes it's deep things that we need help for, but in many ways, the fears that we have can be connected, and often are connected, to what we truly desire. I hope you hear me correctly. There are some fears that we really need help with, unhealthy fears, but there are fears that, you know, that are almost quite simple. You're like, you know, if you hear yourself say that, say for instance, I'm so afraid that I would lose my job. The deeper you go, the more you realize, but wait, who's my provider? Am I my provider? Is it all up to me? Because if it is, then I'm definitely in trouble, and then I should be fearing. If it's all up to us, this fear is real, and you can see it in the world, you know. Unfortunately, also with things like Corona and so on. There's a lot of fear going around. And the deeper we go, the more we see that God is also shaking things. God is shaking things in our hearts to reveal that kind of fear and to make us see what we're actually missing. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. Keep that in your mind. So, if God is who he says he is, wouldn't it be a good thing to fear him? So, in the Old Testament, you read a lot about who the Lord is. I want to get that Psalm. Psalm 97 says, the Lord reigns. Maybe I can give you a bit of time for those of you who want to read with me. Psalm 97, it's quite short. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and burns up his adversaries all around. His lightnings light up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. When we think of who God is, we see that, you know, we only have a glimpse of who he is. But even there in the psalm, you can see that it's almost like when you think of the sun, God is similar to the sun. You know, the sun gives us life. If you look outside, it's beautiful. The sun is shining. The trees are glad. But if you go too close to the sun, what happens? You get burnt. And especially me with my pale skin, you know, I need to be very careful with how, like in Namibia, it's probably 5 to 10 minutes during the summer and I'm burnt, you know. So I need to take care when I approach the sun. When the sun comes on me, I need to take care. And that is a good picture to have of the Lord, that he is so holy, he is so just, he's so righteous, that he cannot allow impurities close to him. We need to realize that before we go into, you know, the good or the healthy parts of grace and so on for us. Because if we start on the wrong end, we will not see God for who he is. And it's very important to see God for who he is. The Lord reigns, let the earth rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and burns up his adversaries all around. So if we approach him in the wrong way, then we should fear. We should, because he's pure. It's his nature. He cannot allow impurities. And if we who are impure approach him, there needs to be another way. Because if you search your heart long enough, you will realize that our hearts have impurities. Our minds have impurities. And it's very, very important. I need to lay emphasis on that, because in our day and age, things are floating around of love and, you know, love wins and this and this and this. But we forget the fear of the Lord, which means we are not wise anymore. We are losing the wisdom because we are losing the fear of the Lord. Amen. But I want to say amen to something that's coming up, which is really beautiful. And that's Jesus' example. I also have the scripture up for you. You can flip the slide. Next one. Jesus. Next one. Okay. So Jesus gives us the most beautiful example. As with everything, he is the presentation of God in flesh. And it says, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow. This is now in Isaiah 11, if you want to turn there. Isaiah 11. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. This is speaking of Jesus. This is long before Jesus came. This is a prophecy of him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. What a beautiful scripture. He will have the spirit of the fear of the Lord, Jesus himself, because he's the Son of God. He's the beautiful representation of what God is like in himself. God is perfect communion in himself. He's a perfect family. If you have a picture of the perfect family, God is the perfect unity. There's no disunity in God between the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. And that relationship that Jesus shows us is one of Father and Son. Jesus is the Son of the Father, submissive to the Father. Even though he is one with the Father, he came and did not see himself equal with the Father. He made himself lower than us. That isn't that a beautiful way of seeing the fear of the Lord? It's a Father-Son relationship. In John 5, verse 19, it says, Jesus gave them the answer, "Very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed." The Son will do nothing apart from the Father. It's a beautiful picture of the submission of the Son to the Father and that healthy fear of the Lord. He is pure. He's holy. He's amazing. We've sung it this morning, you know, how great is our God. The good news of Jesus. It's good news. When you start to see God for who he is and yourself in the light of God, you will find that this is good news, because there's no other way to approach a holy being like God. He's the only holy one. He's the only one worthy. But Jesus came to make a way. Amen. Are you still with me? Jesus came to make a way. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Jesus shows us that very, very perfectly. He says in Matthew 6 verse 9, he says, how should you pray? He starts with, "Our Father." Imagine Jesus had 3 years to change the world, and he had one answer to give in the Bible. How should I pray? The disciples asked, how should we pray? And you know, there are millions of options probably of how you can pray, but Jesus starts with, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Isn't that the relationship that we can have to God, our Father? But not without Jesus. It's only possible with him. Healthy fear of God comes only through Jesus. You must be born again by accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior. In John 4, which was also mentioned in previous weeks, how to worship God. Later on in John 4, it speaks of worshiping God, first of all, in spirit and truth. And then Nicodemus asked Jesus, I think it's John 4 or 3. It's probably John 3. John 3. How shall I be saved? And Jesus says, you need to be born again. How can I approach God? You need to be born again. There's no other way that you can come to the fear of the Lord without being born again. The fear of the Lord leads you to repentance, because you see him for who he is. You see yourself in the light of God, and you realize, without him, I'm really nothing. Healthy fear of God comes only through Jesus. God's righteousness and justice demand that we approach him through Christ. Christ has paid the price for God's justice, and that is good news. It's good news that we need to spread to people around us. The healthy fear of the Lord means that I see myself as the way that Jesus saw the Father and the Father saw the Son. There's a beautiful and very real connection between fearing God like we would fear the Son. So again, this picture of the Son shining on us, but it will burn us without Jesus. If we approach God, like in the Old Testament, there's the story of they were carrying the Ark of God, and the ark had the seat of God on the cherubim, right? And God's presence was resting on the ark. And the ark was slipping, and I think it was Uzziah touched the ark, and he was too impure to touch the ark, and he immediately died. Because your flesh is impure, there's still impurities in you. Without Jesus, the presence of God will destroy everything around it. Which is good news if you are on the side of God. Imagine being on the side of God and all your enemies are subject to him. That is beautiful. That is good news. Amen. Yes, God is a righteous judge. He is an all-consuming fire. We should fear him. We should, you know, if there's anything to fear, it is this beautiful purity of God, because he is righteous. He is justice. The world longs for two things. Justice. If you look all around the world, there's this shout for justice. People on social media are trying to say, yeah, but justice for us and justice for this group. And we need to fight for our justice. But thankfully, we know that through Jesus, he has fought for our justice. God is more just than what we can ever know in this life. But Jesus gives us the access into God's justice through mercy. Think of the cross. The cross has two sides. Justice, perfect justice. If you think that life is unfair, or that, you know, if you look at things that are happening in the world, go back to God. Meditate on the word of God, and you will find that God brings perfect justice. And it's very, very important that we realize that our trust needs to be in him, not in the systems of the world first. Yes, we have wisdom in the systems of the world through God, but we start with God. Pure justice, but awesome mercy, awesome grace. You can go to the next slide. So, in light of all this, how should we worship God? In light of God's purity and holiness and majesty and Jesus' mercy, how should we worship? This has very, very practical implications in our lives. It demands a response from us. When you, I hope most of you probably have accepted Jesus, but if you haven't, first start there. First start with, Jesus is the way to the Father. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That is the absolute truth. Jesus is the absolute truth. And when you start there and you believe in him with all your heart, you are born again. And then there are still implications. You know, that is good news for sure. We are born again into the kingdom of God, a family, like we say this morning. We are brothers and sisters in God's family. How beautiful. The world is looking for a family. And the family is the picture of God. And the world is looking all over, you know, and there's so much happening. If you think of the riots and the things that have been happening last year, and I always go back and see there's a lack of fatherhood. There's really a lack of fatherhood. In my personal life, I was blessed to have my mother and my father for many years. And then all of a sudden, a few years ago, that both of them passed in a short amount of time. And it was tragic, but, you know, the good news is that we are still with the Lord. You know, my whole family has even dug deeper into the Lord. You know, our roots are deeper into the Lord. But with time, you realize that, man, I miss having that number on my phone that you can say, hey, Dad, I'm working on my car. And there's this screw here, and I don't know how to, you know, what does this do, you know? Or how do you build this thing? And with time I realized, you know what? There's a Father that is always with me. I already believed in Jesus, but I didn't have that revelation. There's a Father that when you are at work, going through trouble, or at home, every day, you can, every hour, every second, you can say, Lord, Father, I need you right now. Give me the wisdom that I need in this. You know, give me the practical wisdom. We need practical wisdom in our lives. Life is quite complicated sometimes, but stop. Say, like the father would grab the child that wants to run across the road. Don't just run across the road. Don't just go into that meeting and, you know, try and do it by yourself. If you have a meeting that's important, or, you know, a decision to make, stop. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. James 1 says, if you lack wisdom, you should ask God by faith, and he will give it to you. So stop in the middle of the day. Stop in the middle of the meeting. I mean, we can definitely look at somebody, listen to them, and pray while they're speaking to us. Have you done that? It's very, very good. You know, you can see the Lord's fruit also in your life after a while. You're like, yes, Lord, I realized that you were there with me in that meeting. You were with me in that decision when we had to make a very, very important decision, because we stopped and we recognized God. And I think oftentimes we treat God like a slot machine, you know. We want to, when things go bad, we want to run to it, put in some money and get something out. Or one of these, what are these things called? Vending machines. Vending machines? You know, you want to put in some money, get something out, and walk away and say, God, thank you so much. I've got what I need. I'm going to go on with my life. But when we start with the fear of the Lord as the beginning of wisdom, the healthy fear, then we will say, Lord, you are part of my life. I am in the light of you. I'm the light of the sun of God is shining on me and revealing things in my life. Start with the fear of the Lord. It has practical implications, because I find often that we as believers, we stop with the good news of Jesus saved, yes, and then we don't know what to say anymore. Yeah, it's good news, but you know that the good news has a continuous effect on your life. Not just when you need God, but in your lifestyle, in everything that you do. So, getting back to fear and the fear of the Lord. 1 John 4 verse 18 says, I'm not sure if I put that one up. If you can go to the next slide. Okay, so I've got a few scriptures here as well. So the fear that we should definitely trust God to break in our lives is the fear of the world. 1 John 4 verse 18 says, there's no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. This is now the kind of fear that, you know, that you are fearing something more than you're fearing God. Fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 says, for the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid or fearful, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So I hope it makes sense in a way that, you know, to fear the Lord is healthy. It's a healthy thing. And when you, I often see that when I have to prepare for something, like I use that as an example, you know, say there's a small group and I've got a few songs to sing with them to lead people into the Lord's presence. You know, you don't get paid for it, but then oftentimes I say to someone on stage, say you didn't prepare. And I would give you, next time I'll give you $10 million if you come prepared. Hey, $10 million sounds like a good deal. I will learn that song by heart. You know, I will play my heart out. But the interesting thing is, God is worth so much more. You know, God is worth so much more than money or the things that drive us sometimes in life. Let God be your driving factor, you know? Amen. So, we are no longer slaves to fear, the fear of the world. But we start with a fear of the Lord. We start with that. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All right, so now I want to pray for those of you who don't understand, who have seen God in this light of God will, I'm fearful of God because I don't want to expose myself to him. I want to pray for you firstly, and then we'll pray for others as well. Lord Father God, I pray for those of us this morning who have had a wrong picture of you, Father, who have seen you only in the light of punishment. Yes, Lord, that is one side of you, Father, but through Jesus we can see that we are now called sons of our Father. We can run into the arms of our Father, though he is a righteous judge. He is a consuming fire. He is a majestic, holy God. But we can run into the arms of such a majestic God. So Father, I pray for every heart this morning that has been struggling with this thing of the Lord is going to punish me, or I'm fearful of the Lord. But I pray this morning for revelation through Jesus of your Holy Spirit, Father. A revelation that your Holy Spirit only can bring. We can study the word with our minds, but Father, your Holy Spirit needs to reveal in our hearts who you are. Because once we see you for who you are, we know that we need Jesus. And when we know that we need Jesus, we will surrender our whole hearts to him, because you gave yourself freely for us. It's a free thing. We just need to come and accept the sacrifice that you gave. You bore the cross before you saw the cross, but you feared God more than the cross, because you knew that I want to please my Father. You didn't just fear God in an unhealthy sense, but you feared God because I want to respect my Father. I want to revere my Father, because I see him being amazing. And how much can I do for an amazing God but just to give my everything? And that is a healthy thing, because God is good. You are good, Father. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your love. May you reveal to us the goodness that comes through Jesus. I pray that you soften hearts this morning, that where there has been fear that has been imprinted in our brains, Father, I pray that you break that stronghold of fear over people. That where people are in bondage because of the fear of the world, I pray that you will break that fear and bring the light of Jesus and the healing into our minds, into our bodies, our hearts. May you replace that fear with healthy love, that we approach you with that healthy love, and that we will give our everything, Father. We can give everything to you because you first loved us. Amen. Now I want to pray for us who have known the Lord for a long time, but slowly but surely the fear of the Lord took second place to the fear of the world. If that is you, I want you to pray with me. Father, I thank you for those who have been serving you for many years, or even just a short time, but who have not yet really laid down everything before you. We come before you, Father, and even in my own heart, Lord, I lay down my performances, I lay down my worries, the worries about the past and future and the present, Father. You hold it in your hands, and you want us to walk a road with you, Lord, in this life as well. Yes, we are saved. Thank you for your salvation, Jesus. Thank you. But I also pray for a revelation in our hearts that we need to be the salt and the light on this earth, touching the nations. How can we touch the nations? By fearing God first. And as we fear God, we see the goodness of God through Jesus. And we want to give everything to you, not just a part. Lord, we want to lay down our lives before you, like the woman who broke the alabaster jar and anointed your feet. She saw you for who you are. And she worshipped you, and she gave you all her wages, in a sense. She gave you everything she had and poured it over you because you are worthy. May we in our daily lives, in our workplace, in our school, may we recognize you and see that you are the one who should be praised, who is worthy of our worship. And I pray a blessing over those of us who are struggling at the moment, that you will bless us, Lord, with peace through your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for the privilege of being here this morning together as a family. The world is looking for a family, but we have a Father in heaven. And we will go to the nations. Thank you for Pastor Folko, who's preaching your word in Chobabas this morning. Pray a blessing over him. I pray that as we go into a time of ministering to people in the next month, that that ministry will be from a heart of worship to you. And that even when no one is watching, we will fall at your feet, spend time with you, because you are the most lovely one, you are the holy one, and we have a healthy relationship with our Father. I love you, Father. We love you in Jesus' name. Thank you. Amen. Yes.